Good to see you all. Some of us, I know a lot of us have had busy schedules and busy weeks, and so it's good just that we can all get together today and worship together. And, oh, good, we're up there, good. All right. I am blessed. I am blessed by, I have a wonderful family. I am blessed by all the things that God has given me. I'm blessed by his relationship, by my relationship with God, with Jesus. I am blessed with good health, good friends, and so many material ways I'm blessed. But what does that really mean when you go around saying I'm blessed? What does that mean? What is the meaning of that word blessed or blessing? You know, you'll be on social media or on Facebook, and they like those emojis that say I am feeling, and then they'll stick I'm blessed up there. And you think, okay. You know, and then we get it, we do it so often that we don't treat it very, you know, we kind of just, so, you know, it's not a big deal. Everybody's blessed, you know, in the world here in the United States. I mean, I'm financially rich compared to, you know, 2/3 of the world, so I'm blessed. But is that really what God's talking about when he's talking about blessings? And then sometimes when we say I'm blessed, it's kind of a way to say in a proud way to sound humble. You know, you're saying all these things you have and then tagging blessing on there so that everybody thinks, oh, they're thankful. But they're also kind of showing off everything they have. So in what ways do you feel blessed? Anybody, this is an open thing. What ways do you feel blessed? You have a home to live in. She woke up today. What'd you say, Nina? You have a daughter and some grandchildren, two of them, yes. Anybody else? How are you blessed? I heard something. I didn't get it all. Blessed with our health. Okay. Do opportunities to do new things. Having people that love you, especially a significant other. Having a good church. What'd you say, Randy? Oh, thank you. Awesome. Yep, and we're going to hear from Barb after a little bit here. She's blessed to have God heal her eyesight and that she has a wonderful family. Mm-hmm. So having great-grandchildren around you, that's a huge blessing. Cool. Good. Okay. Okay. They're going to do popcorn, s'mores, and supper. Boy, that's a big night. Uh-huh. Okay. Good. Yeah, it's a blessing to have great-grandchildren to spend time with them. Yep. Yeah, we were blessed to hang out with a daughter and a son yesterday and daughter-in-law and son-in-law, and work really hard. Picked up branches and trees. But we had our health, and we were able to do that, and to be a part of that and help out, that's awesome, to be able to do that. So, you know, those are all things that we say we're blessed about. We are journeying through the book of Matthew over the next few weeks, and we're in week 3. Today is a blessed life. Last week, the message was about the kingdom, that the kingdom is near, that Jesus Christ, we are his kingdom here, that he has filled us, that we are his people, and that we are to live it out now and be prepared for it in the future. And then the first week was, you know, bad things happened. And that's not the title, but right now that just evades me. But bad things happen, but God is good, and he takes us through them, and he helps us through them. And he uses those times to grow us. And he does that with blessings as well. Our journey today takes us to the beginning of Jesus' teaching and preaching And he's preaching to the crowds. We are in Matthew 5, and we're going to be in a very familiar passage that we call the Beatitudes. It's taken from the Sermon on the Mount. And we are going to look at that, and we're going to look at what blessed means. You know, we say yesterday, somebody was sneezing off and on, and I'd say, bless you. And then we say, I'm blessed. And Christians, we use that term a lot. And we tell people that we wish God blesses them, or we pray for that, and we use that term, and we pray God will bless our family. And according to, you know, some of the definitions, one is it's an undeserved gift from God. That's what a blessing is considered. And we talk about ministries being blessed, about what we want to talk about what that really means from Matthew's gospel in chapter 5. Jesus' followers sometimes fell into the trap that we believe that blessed is synonymous with success. If you're blessed by God, you're successful. And we fall into that. Maybe that's the Christian definition of a good life. We are blessed by God. But often that prosperity and abundance needs to be tested through a storm in our life, through bad times happening, because that's when it really shows. Because often it's during those good times that we forget about God, that we totally just kind of walk away from him. And that's what I want to look at first. I'm going to look at first Deuteronomy 8, 10 through 18. Because that's what happened to the people of Israel. God said, you're going to be going into the land of Canaan, and you're going to have everything you need. But beware. So verse 10 through 18 of chapter 8 says, when you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build your fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow and your silver and gold increase and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of a hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands has produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, and follow other, if you ever forget the Lord your, oops, that's the wrong verse, I'm sorry. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your ancestors, as he does today. It is so easy for us to forget about God when things are going good. When we have everything we need, we forget our dependence on God. And God was warning the people of Israel, when you get there, you haven't just arrived. Keep remembering me. Keep me first place in your lives. So moreover, they wouldn't need to cry out to him anymore because now they had everything they need. They totally went away from him. And we kind of criticize the people of Israel often. We'll read through these Old Testament books and think, well, he just did all those miracles. How did they turn away so quickly? But how often do we see that even in our own lives? We forget to give God the credit or thank him for what he has given us. Or we start thinking, oh, look what I did. Or look how good I'm doing. And we forget everything we have comes from God. And they didn't have the gift of the Holy Spirit. They didn't have the power of the Holy Spirit in their lives. And they didn't have the written word to go back to all the time. We have all those things, and yet we still fall into that same trap often. My desire for God is greatly fueled by my need. When I have all my needs met, I can forget about God. I can feel pretty happy with myself. But it's actually in times of loss when I've cried out to the Lord the most. During difficult times in my life, I have went deeper into God's word to find peace and healing and answers. Earthly blessings are temporary. They can be taken away just in a matter of seconds. Hurricanes, floods, tornadoes, all of a sudden, everything we have can be swept away. You know, Job in the Old Testament, he lost everything, even his children, in one day. And that's happened to me in my life as well over a period of years. I've lost lost a lot. Lost the father of my kids, lost a marriage, lost a child, lost another child, lived on welfare, all those things. But those are the things that brought me back to God. Those are the things that got me back to church. Those are the things that continually helps me to keep looking toward Christ. And Barb is going to share with us a little this morning because she wants to share her testimony about what God has been doing in her life. And she's been through some tough times over this last year. So she's going to come on up. And she's going to use Jenny's mic. So if you could turn it up a little bit, maybe. And is it turned on? Nope. I'm going to back out of the way for you.
Can y'all hear me? Okay. First of all, I would like to thank my great church family for all the prayers they through all the prayers while I was going through my surgeries. I would like to thank you for helping me with my bills when I was not able to work. I would like to feel very indebted to the church for everything they've done for me and all the prayers. And I'd like to thank Lee and Mary for being my ride to church and back since I couldn't drive. And also, I would like to thank Camp Victory as they came through for me. And I've needed a new roof on my place for at least 2 years, and I now have a new roof, and I also have new siding on my place. Just tells you how great God is, doesn't it? And also, I'd love to thank Mary for all the rides that she took me to my appointments. Sometimes I was there for 3 hours, and she always dropped me off and came back and got me. And I think it's important that we need to realize that through all of our trials and tribulations, God is always there with us. And I am so thankful for Dr. Starr as my surgeon and everything I've been through. And mostly I'm thankful that I can drive again and go back to work. So again, thank you, South Troy, for everything you've done for me. I am so blessed to have a great church family like you.
That you don't know, Barb, she had a detached retina, and they've been working on it for about a year, isn't it? Or it's been 6 months since April. It just feels like a year, isn't it? Like a long time. Yep. And then a few weeks ago, she went back, and the doctor said it's all back attached, and that they can't explain it. So that is something we need to give God some praise here as well. Yeah, that was a God thing. So, you know, prayer matters, and you are all praying with us and her, and it is so awesome when God answers in a healing like that. So, that's what our trials ground us in our faith in ways that prosperity and abundance never can. While my trials were not blessings in themselves, they were channels for them. That song we sang this morning, Blessings by Laura Story, says, what if your blessings come through raindrops? And troubles and trials. And I, first few times I heard that, I cried every time almost, because that's when they come. That's when we are recognized that they are mercies in disguise that he brings to our lives. This idea of blessing is firmly established in Scripture. According to the NIV Concordance Dictionary, the Greek word for blessed in the passage that we're going to be reading this morning is makarios, the Greek word translated in blessed, and it means to be fully satisfied. So when we're reading that, blessed are you, it is to be fully satisfied. So a blessing then is scripture that shows a blessing is anything God gives that makes us fully satisfied in him. Anything that draws us closer to Jesus. Anything that helps us relinquish the temporary, the temporal, and helps us to hold more tightly to the eternal. And often, It is those struggles and trials, those aching disappointments, those unfulfilled longings that bring us closer to Christ. So as I said, we're in chapter 5, and actually we're going to let the chosen people, Jesus himself in the series, do the Beatitudes for us right now.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven.
For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
You are the salt of the earth.
Okay. Because of time, I am going to skip the scripture part that Pam so greatly put in the PowerPoint this morning, but because they do it word for word there, and I did appreciate that. So as we look at the verses that are in here, verse 3 gets us started. It says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Jesus begins his teaching with blessings and teachings. He's trying to teach the people. He's teaching his disciples as he's teaching the crowd that is there. The Old Testament ended with a curse. If you get to the end of the Old Testament, it ends with a curse. It tells what's going to happen when people don't turn to God. And over the next, 400 years, there was pretty much an empty voice there. But in the New Testament, Jesus begins with blessed. Blessed are you. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those. And we look at that in some of the translations, it renders happy. And that's why I wanted to look up the Greek meaning, because to me, fully satisfied says a lot deeper and a lot more of what Jesus was trying to tell us. Not just to be happy, because happy is an emotion. It's kind of temporal. It's something that everything affects us. We go up and down, happy and sad all the time. But being fully satisfied doesn't always mean we're happy, but it means that we are right where God wants us to be. And that's what we're talking about today. We got to recognize that when we are empty and poor without anything, we can't be filled on our own. And that's what Jesus is saying. Blessed are you when you are the poor in spirit, because you understand that you need me. You need God. Yours is the kingdom of heaven. That's where we start, when we are empty of ourselves and seeking God. In the context of these verses, we read this promise in the present and not future or the past. It's right now. You have the kingdom of God when you recognize that you need Jesus. When you need God in your life. When you're turning to him, you have the kingdom of heaven. You know, we don't have to be noble. We don't have to be a king or a queen. We just need to be empty of ourselves and come to him. Verse 4 goes on. It says, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Now I thought about mourning, and I mean, we're mourned because of death. We share in mourning when somebody passes, and that's our typical idea of mourning. But also, mourning is a time when you are sad or upset about the world we live in, about the culture around us, about the sin that is destroying lives around us. It should break our hearts as believers, what's going on in people's lives around us. That's the mourning that Jesus says, blessed are you when you mourn. When you feel that passion, that pain for other people, and I will comfort you. I will remind you that I am in control. I have a plan. I am there for you, and I will give you the strength you need. You know, we have that sorrow, but it says we'll be blessed, and Solomon spoke about mourning as well, and it helps me to remember that when I go to funerals or when I'm mourning with people around us in those kind of situations. Ecclesiastes 7:2 said, it's better to go to a house of mourning than to a house of feasting, for death is the destiny of everyone. The living should take this to heart. When we're mourning with people, we feel a lot more connected, and we want to help them. We want to share with them the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. A house of feasting, that's a party, and there's nothing wrong with doing that. It's just that it's not as much opportunity to share with somebody about their need for Jesus Christ, because everything, like we said, everything is going good. Everything is great. We're having a party, and we don't want to think about death. But at a time of mourning, at a time when our country and culture is turned away from God, that's a great time to share with people the hope that they can have in Christ, the peace that they can have in Jesus Christ. We find true healing in mourning. Instead of having laughter that's superficial, we can truly come alongside somebody and give them the hope and share with them the hope that we have. And in verse 5, it says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Often, meek gets a really bad rap. We think a meek is somebody that's wishy-washy, that's pasty-faced, that, you know, some of the thesaurus is synonyms for meek are compliant, docile, lenient, mild, passive, spineless, spiritless, subdued, timid, weak, and wishy-washy. None of those sound really good, do they? It's just, blessed are the meek. They're not really positive. None of these are things that we aspire to. Nobody wants to be called spineless, right? But when we look at what Jesus was saying, the definition for it in this passage is he's not telling us to roll over and be a doormat. Meek, another meaning for meek is gentleness, not weakness. Control, not powerless. Willful surrender, not just giving up, not just rolling over and playing dead. That's what true meekness is in this passage. Meekness is understanding your power, your strength, and submitting it to the authority of God. That's what Jesus did. It means that meekness is not spineless. Meekness is not a lack of power. It is meekness is power under control. It means you're not really impressed with yourself. You can control yourself. You can be who God has called you to be without trying to impress anybody else. And you can trust God with who you are. That's what that kind of meekness is. And we can only do that when we're poor in spirit, when we truly recognize who we are in Christ. It carries with us the idea of not having to be in control, but surrendering to God. And sometimes that's hard to do because it's hard to let go of what we think we need to do or our plans are. And we need to surrender those things to God. And often he's going to often take you to where you thought you were going anyway. But he needs you to say, you first. God, you're first. I'm going to follow you no matter what is happening. The Greek word from which we get the word meek comes from the taming of a wild animal. You know, they don't lose all their wildness, but their strength, they're tamed under control. The picture I like as well is of these massive Clydesdale horses. You know, well, any horse really, because I mean, I'm sitting there with my horse and I'm running, and I go out, and you know, if that had, if they really wanted to do whatever they wanted to do, I mean, that's 1,000 pounds. I am no match for an 1,000-pound horse. They can do whatever they want if they choose to do it, right? Well, I want to show, there's a clip here of the Clydesdales, and hopefully we can get to that. And I think you can see what I mean. But it's so fun to watch them, but they definitely are under control. Imagine if those 8 horses decided that they were going to go the other direction. Could that guy really stop them up there with those bridles? Nope, they could take off anytime. That is strength. That's what meekness is really about. It is strength under control. Though they're powerful animals, but they're tamed. Only people submissive to God and following him will inherit the earth. We need to follow Jesus to be strong and under control, fully surrendered like Jesus Christ was. Verse 6 says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. We are to be people that are filled with God's righteousness, not just full of our own righteousness, but long for more and more of God's righteousness. We are to long for who he is, and his direction and his will in our lives. We need to be people of light, both with God and with people. We long to see righteousness in our culture, in our families, in our own lives. We need to desire that all people have a deep and rich relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what it means to seek that for ourselves. And as we seek that, we're able to reach out to others and share with them who Christ is, who God is. And that's the kind of relationship that God desires for us. We desire that all people have a deep and rich relationship, and that Christ fills them with the passion for goodness and righteousness, the desire to live in a way pleasing to God. Not just for pleasing ourselves, but pleasing to God and pleasing and to work with the people around us. We desire to see God work in each human heart so that each person can have a relationship with Jesus Christ. We forget, we learn to lead out, to have joyful confidence that one day we'll be in heaven with him. Not just in this, we're with him now, serving him and living for him and reaching out, but we know that when we die, we're going to heaven. We're going to see Jesus' face. We're going to be right there with him and enjoy all the joy that we can have for eternity. That's what Jesus is saying to the people. And then verse 7, it says, blessed are the merciful, for they should be shown mercy. The people of God, those that are blessed, are people that forgive because they've been forgiven. They're people that judge charitably. They don't condemn others. They're patient, long-suffering. Starting to sound like some fruit of the Spirit there. But that's what God, when we follow Jesus, if we want to be blessed people, that's who we are. We need to live that out. It helps me all the time to remember how much God has forgiven me. That helps me to forgive others and to be more patient. That's where I struggle. I think, they should be this far along already in their faith. And God says, wait a minute. How long did it take you? And be patient and to just continue to pray and to be there and help them. We help the needy. We help people in their need. What we are to others, God will be to us. What we are to others, God will be to us. To be kind, some have to work to overcome their stinginess, but the blessing lies in doing a merciful act and being merciful in disposition. Because we can't just do it and then act like we're a jerk handing it out. We need to be merciful and loving as well when we show mercy. Followers of Jesus must be people of mercy, for they have found mercy because mercy has found them. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Those of us, when we are pure in heart, we will see God. So the psalmist cries out in Psalm 51, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. Create in me a pure heart, a clean heart, O God. We ask him to come in and clean us up. That's what happens when we receive Jesus Christ as our Savior. We ask for him to come in. We say, I'm sorry. Forgive me for my sins. I know I'm a sinner. I'm far away from you. And he comes in, and it's like he cleans us up. There's totally no sin. We've been made holy in his sight. He forgives us. And then we can come to him, and we will see God. When we receive that salvation, one day we will see him face to face. And we can see him now in our lives and in other people's lives as we live out the kingdom of God here as well. Only purity has any idea of God or genuine vision of him. It's the only way we can't see God unless we have come to that place where we're willing to be emptied of ourselves and allow him to fill us. Only those who have received the forgiveness of their sins through Jesus Christ will one day see God in heaven. Too often, in verse 9, it says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. And sometimes we think peacemakers, they kind of belong into the meekness category. They do whatever they can to make peace with each side. But Jesus said, people of peace are the children of God, are children of the God of peace. And God's blessing rests on them. We're people of peace. We do as much as within us to live at peace with everybody. There are going to be people you can't make peace with because they refuse to be on that side of it. But then, you know, that's all we can do. What God has called us to do is to extend that right hand of fellowship. We aren't responsible for how they take that. And in Romans, it says that as much as it depends on us to live in peace with everybody. So we talk about that a lot on Sunday nights to celebrate recovery. That's one of the steps, is to make amends. And there are times when you can't reconcile. You can't make amends with some people. Sometimes it's because they're gone. Sometimes it might hurt them more than help them or hurt us. But often it's, you know, you'll go and make amends. That other person doesn't have to receive that and doesn't have to forgive you. And that's a hard place to get because you're doing the right thing, yet they're not ready. But Jesus said, that doesn't matter. He says, you do your part. And that's what Jesus is saying here. That's being a peacemaker, doing all that you can on your end of it, and then giving the rest to him. When we do that, we are the children of God. He calls us his sons and daughters because, hey, they're doing what I've asked them to do. I love them just where they are. Too often we see peace as non-aggressive coexistence. A judge once asked a fellow that he was sentencing, does your conscience ever bother you? Have you ever thought about what God thinks of your actions? To which the criminal said, I've always been at peace with God. He don't bother me and I don't bother him. But Jesus said that's not what we're to be doing. He says, the peace is we, not you. Peace is we, not I. Even with the Cold War over international peace, we have this balance of terror. That isn't peace. That's just an agreement not to blow each other up. That's not peace. Peace is learning to give to that other one. It's a relationship. And peace will never be gained until all sides finally come to that place where saying, yes, we're done. We're laying it down. And they find peace with God. And the result of being a peacemaker, Jesus says, they shall be called the sons or children of God. God is a supreme peacemaker. And he wants us to continually follow him. Matthew 12:50 says, "For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." When we do God's will, when we're following him, we are peacemakers. The 10th verse says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." We're the blessed ones when we're persecuted for doing right. Most of us don't like that one because it's kind of painful. We always like likes. We like to everybody to like us, to love us, to accept us. It's just not going to happen if we're living Christ-filled life. We will be persecuted if we're following Jesus. And it's absurd for us to think we can escape suffering. Jesus said, "You will have trials and suffering." Jesus said in John 15, "If the world hates you, keep in mind it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you don't belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That's why the world hates you. Remember the words I spoke to you. No servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If they obeyed my teaching, they would obey yours too. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me." As believers, if you're not being persecuted, maybe your witness isn't very strong. Because when we are truly living a God-filled life, there are going to be people that disagree with us. There are going to be people that are going to treat us disrespectfully because of how we live. Now, we have to realize Christ is saying this, and that it's everyone that calls himself by his name eventually will suffer persecution. It's inevitable. We will suffer for doing right. And that's hard. It's hard for us as we like democracy. We like things to be fair. How often do you hear that from your family or kids or when you were a kid? That's not fair. Well, Jesus said it ain't gonna be. You will be persecuted. But I looked at the book. When I was thinking about that, I was thinking about the book of Acts. When the disciples rejoiced for being persecuted. How many of us rejoice when we're being persecuted? But I loved it because in Acts 5:40-42, the high council had called all the apostles in. They had arrested them. They said, "Okay, guys, what are we going to," they were going to kill them. They were trying to figure out what to do. And one of the leaders said, "If this is from God, you're not going to be able to stop them, even if you kill them. So why don't kill them? Just see how it plays out. Because that God might have sent them. And if that's true, then we're not going to be able to stop them." So they agreed not to do anything. They agreed just to flog them. So they did punish them, and then they let them go and told them not to do it anymore. And so how they responded. "The apostles left the high council rejoicing that God had counted them worthy to suffer disgrace for the name of Jesus. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they continued to teach and preach the message, Jesus is the Messiah." They rejoiced because they were counted worthy to suffer. Because they were doing what God had called them to do, and they were preaching the truth. They were sharing about Jesus, and they were suffering for it. Sometimes we back away when we might have to suffer for it. We don't want to share because somebody might be offended. And then that way we don't suffer anything, do we? But here it says we need to stand for what the faith, to share our faith unashamedly. And no matter what the consequences. And rejoice when people tell us to go fly a kite. Or whatever they might say. We need to be faithful no matter how much it hurts sometimes. And then just to think that Jesus went through it, the disciples, we're in good hands. We're in good company when that happens to us. You're not alone. It's been done before, and it's going to continue. In fact, as the days and years continue, it's just going to get worse as followers of Christ. "Blessed are you when men revile you and people treat you bad, when you're found worthy to suffer disgrace for the name of Jesus. He who called you has called you worthy to suffer." Ray Stedman tells a story of an old missionary couple, and that's what I'm going to close with. It was a long time ago. This missionary couple was on a cruise ship with Teddy Roosevelt. They were coming back from Africa. The couple had been missionaries, faithful missionaries. And they'd been doing this for years and years and years. And Teddy Roosevelt was on there. He had been on a safari. He liked to shoot wild game. So here he's coming home, and they're coming home. They get off the same ship. And President Roosevelt gets this huge homecoming. Everybody's so glad the president is back. They're just very, you know what they do with presidents. I mean, they're just really excited. But this missionary couple, nobody meets them. Nobody even tells them, thank you for your service. They get off the boat, and that night they're in a cheap little apartment. The man's spirit is just busted. He's just devastated. He says, Lord, I've given you all these years. And that president, I mean, he's a president, sure, but what has he done for the kingdom? I mean, I've been serving you for all these years, and I don't get anything. I'm in this cheap apartment. I don't have a lot of finances, and I just feel forgotten. And he tells his wife that, and he says, I can't take this. God's not treating us right. It's not fair, he tells his wife. So she says, why don't you go to the bedroom, tell the Lord how you feel? And he did. He took his wife's advice. He went and told the Lord how he felt. A short time later, he came out of the bedroom, and his wife could tell that God had talked to him, that he had heard from the Lord. And she said, you know, what had changed? She says, dear, what happened? Well, the Lord settled it with me. He said, I told him how bitter I was with the president to receive this tremendous homecoming when no one met us when we came back home. And when I finished, it seemed as though the Lord put his hand on my shoulder, and he said, you're not home yet. You're not home yet. We need to remember that we're not home yet. No matter what happens in this life, he's going to see us through, he's going to be with us, but he doesn't promise us happily ever afters, except forever after with him. So when we face persecution, when we face trials, when we have a hard time being under control, and we want to lose it and tell somebody off, we want need to be meek. When all those things in the Beatitudes are not easy platitudes. They're things that God will give us the power and strength to do. But when we get there, we need to remember that when you surrender yourself to Jesus, you are blessed. And that's what the Beatitudes is all about, surrendering yourself to God's will for you. But that starts with a faith in Jesus Christ. If you haven't surrendered that first step, none of the rest is going to happen anyway, because he can only come in and live in you. But then after that, he will continue to fill you and give you the power and strength you need to be that woman, that man of God that he's called you to be. And one day, he's going to come up to you and he's going to say, you're not home yet. One day we will be. And always remember that when you hit something hard. Because blessed are you as you surrender yourself to living the life Jesus calls you to do. And remember, you're not home yet. Let's pray. Jesus, some days are hard. And, you know, we think of the Beatitudes, and we usually think of them with a smile, and they're just a wonderful bunch of savings. But, Lord, when we dig down into the meat of what you were really saying to the people at that time period and what you are saying to us now, well, it's not so easy. But with you, all things are possible. With you, we can do anything because you have put your spirit within us. You have brought your kingdom to us, and you live in us. And Lord, I'm praying for the one now that maybe hasn't taken that first step, that hasn't said, Jesus, I surrender. I agree with you. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe I'm a sinner and I need you. Lord, I pray for that one to make that decision even today to say, yes, Lord, I surrender. And to those of us that are fighting you or struggling right now or just going through a hard time, help us to remember that your blessings are real and new every morning, and that you love us. You know what's best for us and that you will get us through. And Lord, help us all when we hit those hard times, when we are persecuted this week or next week or in the future. Help us rejoice and count ourselves worthy, to be found worthy of suffering for you. Thank you for your strength. Thank you for your blessings on our lives. Thank you that you want us to be fully satisfied in you. Oh, Lord, lift us up today. Thank you for the amazing and awesome God you are. And we pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Yeah. If you would stand with us, we'll